Hey everyone, welcome back to my video series on low frequency RFID. The Flipper Zero is a great multi-tool, but today I wanted to demonstrate how we can use the Proxmark 3 for looking at Manchester encoded data. The Proxmark advertises itself as the Swiss Army knife for RFID security research. In this video, we'll be looking at the EM4100. And then we'll also take a look at the InstaFob. Let's get started. So I built this to show a simulation of what happens when you put a tag and put it on the reader. I have a function generator at 10 kilohertz. So this coil's at 10 kilohertz. And on the oscilloscope, we can see this 10 kilohertz signal. Normal RFID is 125 kilohertz, but the principle's the same. Here I have a pickup coil, and it acts just like the coil in my tag. So when we put this coil next to our reader coil, you can see that the signal changes slightly and gets detected. It's also generating power. You can see that I'm getting some voltage. When I pull it out, I don't have voltage. When I put it in, I'm getting power. That power would power our little integrated circuit inside of here. And then... when we want to send data, this would basically short these two wires, and this switch shorts the wires too. So the IC uses this to send a signal. And on our oscilloscope, we can see that the reader is able to see this fluctuation in voltage as the bits are going zeros and ones. If we can get our tag better aligned with our reader, I'll simulate that with this rod. You can see that the voltage now is less voltage, and it's jumping way down, so it's a lot easier to read. And so that's the basic idea behind how the tag communicates with the reader. And again, it's harder to see it if it's not aligned, but when it's aligned well, you can really see that jump. This video is not covering Proxmark setup. I use the WSL2 instructions. I'll put a link in the video description. The first command we'll look at is help. In this video, we'll be using the data command and we'll be using the LF command. We'll start with LF-H, and you can put a dash H on any command to get help. At the top, you can see all the protocols that are supported, and the bottom is all the general commands. Next, we'll run LF space tune dash H to get help for that. And then we'll just run LF tune. You can see the millivolts in the volts, and as we put a tag in different spots of the reader, you can see those change. We're trying to find the location where this would have the smallest number. I'll go ahead and run it with the dash V option for verbose, and then the dash dash mix to show mix style. So now we have the data plus a power bar that we're trying to reduce. And you can see different spots. And then press enter to stop the scan. One thing I forgot to show was, let's go ahead and run it again. When you flip it over, you may get different results. So try both sides and try moving it around. This time we'll go ahead and run it just to see how tight that range can be if we don't move it. Next, instead of the tag, we'll try one of these cards that has a 5577 chip in it. And you can see that that significantly drops because of the larger antenna. Next, we'll run LF-H. And we're interested in the EM4100, so we'll be using the EM command. In my previous video, we looked at the configuration and user data blocks for facility code 101, card 29649, 1A016573D1 was the data. So we'll go ahead and do LF-EM-H. We want the EM410X, but you only have to type in the unique amount of characters, so you don't need the 0X. You can delete that. And this is true of all the commands. So RE would be reader, BR for brute force. Next, we'll add the clone command so that we can clone it to our tag. And you can see that it takes a dash dash ID option. And then we'll pass 1A0165 73D1. And again, that ID is what we used on the Flipper. and we'll run LFEM41 reader, and it successfully read our tag. Next, we'll use our flipper to try to read that tag. So we'll go in and say read ASK, put our tag against there. There it is, EM41-H. And this time we'll use the sim command. And the sim command also takes the dash dash ID, 1A016573D1. And so now our Proxmark is simulating this tag. We no longer need the tag. And we'll go ahead and on our flipper, we'll try to read the Proxmark. And there it is, EM41-H. And this time we're going to do reader. And nothing's on the Proxmark, so reader will just return nothing. On our flipper, we'll go into more, and then we'll choose emulate, put that on our Proxmark, and then we'll rerun that reader command, and there it is. So this time, the Proxmark read the flipper emulating that code. We'll put the tag back on our Proxmark and run the reader. There it is. We'll run lf-h. And then LF read dash H. We can accept those defaults. So we'll just do LF read. And then we'll use LF search to try to identify what's in our read buffer. It correctly identified it as an EM4100. And in other, it has our 29649 and our 101. It's also identified that the underlying chip is a T5577 chip and that there's those commands we could run. So we'll go ahead and run LFT55-H and then LFT55Detect-H. And we didn't enable any password protection, so we can just run LFT55Detect and there's our chip. LFT55Info. And we can see that it's using RF64 as its data rate. It's using a config block of 148040. We have this data matches our config block from our previous video. And in our video, we had Manchester, RF64, and two user data blocks. And here we can see RF64, Manchester, and two data blocks. And you can see our config block. And that config block matches two different protocols, EM and Paxton. LFT55-H. And then we'll use LFT55Dump-H. We don't have any password set, so we can just run the T55Dump command. And in page zero, you can see our config block matches and our two user data blocks match. That third through seventh user data blocks are unused. So they're whatever data was on the chip previously. LF-H, LF-read-H, and then LF-read. That read the signal from our tag. LF-search to try to identify the signal that we read. There's our EM4100, data-h, and this time we'll use data, the plot function to show the graph window. So data plot-h, it looks like there's no settings there. So now we're able to visualize our signal, and the plot has annotated in blue our zeros and ones, and there's all of our ones and our zeros and our ones, and our zeros, and our one, and all of our zeros. So the data we received matches up with those bits from our video. Next, I'll do an LF read to just read the information from the tag again. And now there's no annotation. Instead of detecting our data, we'll try to figure it out. So let's do data raw demod-h. And we'll start with demodulating it as a raw, ASK raw. So dash dash AR is the switch for ASK raw. Sorry, dash dash AR. There we go. And when we look at this data, we see a lot of 0 1s and 1 0s. So this definitely looks like Manchester encoded data as we're looking around and seeing a bunch of 0 1 and 1 0s here. Next, let's try NRZ direct. And that is dash dash NR as the option. So we'll do NR and scroll up. And again, we're seeing a bunch of 0 1s. So this was 10010110. This is 01101001. So kind of the inverse of the other one. But we still definitely see that there's Manchester data here that we would need. So let's run the help command again. And Manchester is the AM switch. So we'll do AM for Manchester. Dash dash AM. So it decoded our data, but it also found the tag that was in there. So we have our zeros and ones, and that all looks correct with our AM. And if we look along, here's all of those ones that we started with, and then our zeros, and then our ones, and then our zero and our one, and then all those zeros. So this is how I investigate low frequency tags using the Proxmark. And we can see again, there's the EM4100 and our facility and card number. Next, I wanted to look at the InstaFob. These are available at Home Depot and Lowe's. And basically they have a programmer that you can program your fob onto one of these InstaFobs. Both of these are unprogrammed. So we want to see if we can identify an unprogrammed InstaFob and also if we could reset an InstaFob to its initial state. The first command we'll do is help, and then we'll go ahead and do an LF-H, and then we'll do an LF-tune, and then we'll figure out where this fob needs to be sitting to get a good signal. That looks good. Next, we'll do an LF-read. And then we'll do an LF search to try to find this tag. So a new tag isn't matching any protocols, but we can see that the chip got detected as a T5577. We'll do an LF T55-H. And then we'll do an LF T55 detect. And then LF T55 info. And there's our config block. It looks good. We have RF32. Manchester, and 7 is our max block, and sequence terminator, yes, 880E8. And in terms of the config block match, it's saying it matches the T5577 default. LF T55 dump. And again, block 0 is our config block. And our max block was 7. Max block 7 means that all 7 blocks will be sent out using RF32 modulation. This block's interesting, 107060. That may just be the data signature that's in these chips, but that looks like 107060 sounds like a modulation that's pretty common in our other videos. Let's do a info.h. There's a dash C that we can use. And we can pass in a config block and it'll decode it for us. Yes, so RF50, and that's used for HID and AWID. So definitely we've been using this in our other videos for our config block. I'll do an LF dump, sorry, LF T55 dump. And there's our page zero data. Now we're ready to swap over to the other unused tag and see what happens with it. We'll do our LF T55 detect. Our config block matches the other one. LF T55 dump. Our config blocks match and our max block is still 7. So in block 2, we're seeing 3, 4, 800 and 107060 is still in block one. So that looks like a fingerprint we can use. We'll go ahead and do an LF read to read the data from the chip. And then we'll do a data-H. And we're interested in the raw demod command, dash H. We'll start with the AR for ASK raw. Dash dash AR. And we're seeing a bunch of 1010. So that looks like it's Manchester encoded, which matches what we saw in our config block. And dash AM is showing us our Manchester data. I'll do AM dash H. And there is this dash dash ST for check for sequence terminator. And so we want to use dash dash ST without the dash H switch. And now this is kind of just a matter of trying to find the right spot so that we get the output we need. So we need to do another read and then the ST. Now we're seeing the dots are the terminator, but we're seeing too many of them and not in a kind of a pattern. So this usually takes me a couple tries. I'm not sure if there's a better way. And now we have a very nice pattern where they're clearly spaced equal distance apart from each other all the way up. And again, that's our terminator. So our data starts right after the two dots. So I'll go ahead and copy that data over into Notepad and we'll format it into just one big binary number. Remove all the extra characters and then we'll copy it to our clipboard and paste it into the calculator. It looks like I have too many digits for the calculator, so we'll paste a few less into binary. And then I'll go ahead and add another zero. And there's our data in hex. And you can see that information is matching the block one and block two information. So this means we should be able to write an encoder and decoder for the flipper zero that uses this configuration of 880E8 and can write T5577 tags as blank instafobs. And it can read those tags and look for that 107060 signature to detect it as an instafob tag. Please like and subscribe. And don't forget to turn on notifications so you get notified when that next video comes out on programming the flipper to recognize instafob. If you have any questions, please leave a comment below or on my Discord server.